Hello and welcome to episode 61 of Adult Music, the podcast with music for the mature mind.
61? Holy cow!
Holy cow! Yeah, it's getting up there.
I can't believe we're still doing this.
I know. I guess it's like okay. Some kind of addiction or something now.
Yeah, I think we now have more podcasts than listeners.
Could be.
Come on, listeners. We know you're out there.
We'll be crossing the 10,000 downloads mark soon.
Oh, really? Will we really? How many do we have now?
Well, I don't know. Getting up close to 8, I think so.
8,000. Okay, that's not bad. So getting close to 8,000. I haven't been checking.
And we have more countries, people around the world listening to us.
That's cool. I've been too busy listening to CDs.
That's right.
To check. So there you go.
Well, that's been the best part about doing this. I mean, other than talking with you, of course.
Oh,
my good old friend.
You flattered me.
My good old friend. But, you know, with everything that you can listen to and find at your fingertips, it's overwhelming. So you need kind of a strategy.
Yeah.
And even if you, you know, start looking at things, you're going to be tempted to just gloss over things a lot. So this has really given us a chance to focus on some things along with finding new things and look deeply into the music. Yeah, I like that.
Have you ever seen the movie Until the End of the World, the Wim Wenders movie from the 90s?
I think I've seen that, yeah.
Yeah, it's at the very... At the end of the movie, like the whole Earth power grid goes down because some satellite gets shot down or something, and there's no electricity, and they all have to live sort of without that. And I'm just thinking that if ever the whole internet goes down and nobody has music anymore, I will have some for us in the man cave that we inhabit here in Japan.
You've got your CDs, and
got my
if
CDs.
The electricity goes out, you can. Just come over here.
Then I just have to read books, I guess. But I do have books. That's one thing. I don't have the those electronic book things. I was out at a barbecue with a bunch of tech guys recently, and they admired me for what they called being off the grid because I don't have an iPhone. I have an iPod Touch because I like listening to music all the time. But I don't have an actual iPhone, and they thought that was impressive. You'd think they'd be making fun of me, but it was the opposite. They kind of I think they're kind of
– They envied you.
They're kind of longing for that, you know – pre-iPhone world themselves.
Yeah. So, before anyone could find you 24 hours a day.
I really do resent that. I like not being able to be contacted, especially if I'm outside. You know, I don't want people just calling me out of the blue. You know,
you got to shut it off sometimes. You got to cut the link.
Right, exactly.
Well, if you've got any new listeners who don't know us yet, that's Mike over there.
That's me. I'm Mike. Yeah.
Without the iPhone. That.
And, I'm the guy without the iPhone and with the CDs.
And all the CDs.
Yeah.
And I'm Russ over here. I've got CDs. I've got other things too.
He's got quite a bit of CDs, yeah.
I like my CDs. Yeah. I like streaming too. Gadgets and things.
I like streaming. It's good enough. It's good for, you know.
It's good as CD now in some cases. So.
Yeah.
But it's nice to have something to touch and hold.
Yes.
And read.
And read too.
Yeah,
I have something funny about this too. I was listening to some recent, I guess, rock popular music recordings. I was listening to the new Kurt Vile album. He's not the musical theater composer from Germany, but the guitarist from Philadelphia. He spells his name Vile.
Oh, okay, I see.
And there's an album by a band called The War on Drugs, also from Philadelphia. So I was listening to them today, and I noticed that like popular music with me, any kind of popular, it doesn't register unless I'm listening to it like on a CD on a nice stereo. Because I'll go outside and I'll have the headphones on and I'll play it through the iPod Touch, and it's kind of AIFF. But nevertheless, there's some dimension that comes out of the stereo that kind of makes it. Kind of stick more. It's a dimensionality thing too. I can kind of feel there's something more solid.
Feel
about
it in
the
your
sound.
Chest. Yeah,
I
know.
I don't know. Maybe that's it. I don't know. Yeah. But I need the CDs. I will. You know, I'm going that way, and they're coming back. Apparently, people are listening to CDs more.
Yeah.
You know, according to
that's
the press, but who knows?
Yeah. You know. Otherwise, after the apocalypse, there won't be anything left to identify our musical civilization.
Right. I'm going to have something to say about CDs when we get to the jazz section of tonight's podcast. So,
okay.
You know,
media
so
matters.
Remind me.
All right. Well, before we get into our program for tonight, I want to remind our listeners and also let any new listeners know that in the episode description, you'll find links to all the music we'll talk about. There's Spotify and Apple there, direct streaming links. Also, you can get all the music in one place on Deezer. That's the streaming platform we like best. You get your music in CD quality. You can listen to the podcast there as well. Just look for us, Adult Music Podcast. And on Deezer, we also put up the recordings for next week, right after the podcast goes up. So if you want to see the music for the upcoming episode, you can check that out a week early. And if you can't see the links clearly on whatever podcast platform you listen to us on, please pop over to our host, Podbean, and everything's easy to connect to and see there. Now, if you enjoy the podcast, please follow or subscribe on whatever app or platform you listen to us on. Take a minute, give us a ranking or write a review. That will help us get listed in the browsing category recommendations. That helps us grow our audience. And thanks to you, we've been in Apple music commentary recommendations for a few weeks straight now, which is nice. You can also find us on Facebook. I put the Deezer playlist post there every week early. And you can leave us a message or a comment. You can see our handsome faces there if you take a look. And you can also contact us directly the old way by email at adultmusicpodcast@gmail.com. Any questions or comments? We'd like to hear from you.
Yeah, you can also write comments on our Facebook page. I just wanted to mention, I put up the three CDs that I'm going to be talking about today, a photo of them, on the Facebook page. And it got only one hit. And I think that hit was me. I think I'm the only one that looked at it. So give us a look at our pages, make us feel good at least, you know, just even if you don't want to, just go there.
Yeah, I put up a video of that Barry Onda recording from last week.
Oh, that was good. One. Yeah.
So I might start doing that when I find associated videos of the recordings we have. I'll post them up there.
I have a growing list of jazz recordings that we've talked about that I really liked that aren't available on CDs. I keep them on the list in case they ever appear in the future. But I just want to say to any jazz artists out there, you know, I know it's hard to do if you're just starting out or something like that, but put your music out on CD if you can, right? Because years down the line, it'll still be on my shelf, whereas I'll probably forget about it if it's just in some, you know, streaming service, you know, right, which I might not even be registered for by then, you know, so.
That's right. There, and it'll go on to the next generation.
Yeah, I could hand it to my, no one in my family wants anything I have. Although my brother Richard, the guy who, whose shop designed the, our logo, seems to be listening more and more. So I'm kind of wondering, you know, what he's, you know, what he's getting out of this, you know what I mean? Because his daughter dances, so he listens to a lot of classical music because of her, and I think he just wants to know something about it. Hmm. But I'm wondering if he actually listens to it actively now, you know, apart from, you know, the dance things. Speaking of dance things, I think we've got a, we're starting out with a little dance thing tonight. Are we ready to get into these recordings?
I think we're ready to get into them, starting out with the classical world.
Yeah, and our first recording. Now, we have a new segment that we said that this is one of our two segments.
That's right.
The Ranitzky releases, and those words are both spelled with a W for those of you keeping score at home. And we even have a theme now for this Ranitzky releases segment of the program. So, Russ, can you play the theme? Play me
All
in?
All right. I know Daniel's going to love this.
And there it is. Okay. Whenever you hear that, you know we're going to talk about a Ranitzky recording.
That's right.
A Ranitzky recording. Hunt. That's WRECORDING. Okay.
That's right. So for any new listeners to the podcast, in one of our early episodes, I think it was episode 10.
It was episode 10.
I had uncharacteristically found a classical recording and said, "Hey, Mike, what about this?" And I said, "I never heard of that." And I said, "Neither have I. So let's listen to it." It was the first volume of Ranitzky recordings, kind of a composer who has been overlooked through history, and now is his music is making a comeback in a big way.
Yeah, that's all really thanks to Daniel Bernardson, who's one of the, he may be the chief scholar of Renitsky's music. And I got to tell you, this has been quite a surprising and enjoyable journey listening to his music. The first three, Naxos has been releasing these most of these albums. We've also got some on other labels now, which is also really nice to see. But the Naxos series continues. The first three dealt with symphonies. And we liked Volume 3 the best, if you're just going to go out and pick one up just at random. We thought that was the most energetic sounding one. I remember with Volume 1, I thought it was kind of lacking in energy, but it got better as they went. But the thing is, we now have Orchestral Works 4, Volume 4 on Naxos. And this is a, what would you call this? This is a pantomime or sort of a dance
ballet
piece. I guess a pantomime would be like a light ballet or just kind of. Right. And it's called Das Waldmädchen, The Forest Maiden. There's also a piece called Pastorale in Allemande at the end. This is, once again, by the Czech Chamber Philharmonic Orchestra Pardubice, conducted by Marek Štilek, and we, of course, interviewed both of them way back last year in 2021. This is Volume 4 in the series, and it was recorded in 2020 before we started this podcast. They must have so much stuff in the can there. How much more of this is there? I want to just encourage Naxos Records to get this orchestra back in the studio, recording more. Yeah. Renitsky, it's actually really picking up quite a lot, because this is another really excellent recording. Yeah. I want to say right away, right at the beginning, great performance, good energy throughout, and a great recording as well. This is really hits on all levels. Okay, so the pantomime Das Waldmädchen, it's a little over an hour long. It's the music for this ballet pantomime. I'm going to really go heavily into Daniel's notes, his very detailed notes about this pantomime. Nothing is really left to the imagination, because he really fills in all of the details of the story. You usually don't get things this detailed with a ballet performance, and you're left wondering what's happening at what point. Right. Not here with the ballet notes. He's filled it all in.
And I'll say that he sent us the score, which has the performance notes, and that's not available on the Renitsky Project page yet, but I think it says it will be there soon. So I'll put up the link if you're more interested to find out about Renitsky as a composer and all the other available recordings. I'll put up the link for the Renitsky Project on the page. It's just renitsky.com, and I think the score will be up there soon if you want to follow along on your own.
Yeah, so Renitsky, he lived at around Mozart and then young Beethoven's time, and he knew both of them, and as well as Haydn. So all the big shots of the day, and he was apparently one of them as well. It's just that we just don't remember his music, but he had his benefactors, as did many people then, and it's due to them, especially one who I got to scroll down here. Empress Marie Therese especially liked his music and collected a lot of it, so we're getting a lot of it from her collection long ago. All right, this particular piece, Das Waldmädchen, is pretty much almost the entire album. There's one more short piece at the end. This is a work that premiered at the Kärntner Theater in Vienna on 23 September, September 23rd, 1796, the day before my birthday. Well, 200 years before I was born. But, so they knew I was coming, I like to think, anyway. And it was part of a double bill. The other one was a play, I think. And it quickly became an audience favorite, was performed 130 times in the following years, which is a lot. Okay. Yeah. It's even a lot today. If you're putting on a play, think about it. If you're in Broadway in New York, how long do most musicals go? Maybe a few months, unless they become super popular. And so 130 performances is quite a lot then. In the notes, Daniel compares it to Beethoven's, Creatures of Prometheus, which only had about 28 performances, which I guess is standard, but I don't think that was a successful stage work for Beethoven. Beethoven really wasn't a stage work composer. He also did an opera, which we now know very well, but I don't think that really drew lots of audiences to.
Maybe it was the Forest Maiden idea.
Oh, did he? Oh, the Creatures of Prometheus? Which
no,
one?
No, I mean, in this case.
Yeah, maybe the idea.
The Forest Maiden, you know.
Yeah.
I hung out a lot in the woods, but I never saw any maidens in the forest. So.
Yeah, basically, this is kind of the old story where the maiden is in the woods living somehow.
The feral girl.
These highly civilized royal people find her and bring her back and to civilization, basically. And it's, you know, the whole fascination with seeing the world through this wild girl's eyes. There are a lot of stories like this. There's Romulus and Remus is sort of like this in ancient Rome. You know, they even founded their city on a similar story. Anyway, the story basically involves Floreski, a Polish prince, Floreska, his consort. How convenient, huh? Mm. They both have almost the same name. Lovenski, who is Floreska's brother, and also a Polish prince. Oh, he's also a Polish prince, Lovenski, okay? And Azemia, who is the flower maiden, the Waldmädchen. She's a young maiden who was abducted from her parents as a baby, and she's grown up alone in the forests of Lithuania.
Nice setting.
That's quite a setting. Anyway, this sort of thing was really a big subject of fascination with people in this era and the Romantic era as well. Mm. There's also minor characters, Petrushka, who is a Cossack hunter employed by Prince Floreski, and Monsieur Sison, a dancing master, chambermaids, hunters, attendants, etc. All right, anyway, listening to this, I actually kind of wrote down Daniel's notes in my notes so that I could kind of follow along with the action, what was happening. Now, I should mention this ballet, or call it a pantomime, really, pantomime dance piece. It's a lot like a lot of 19th century ballets go, where the material doesn't really highlight the action. It just sort of serves as something for the story to sort of take place over. So there are a lot of sort of sections that, you know, they change to indicate like changes of moods, but it doesn't do any painting. There's no tone painting in this, so that we, like when somebody's like excited, you know, the music will get a little excitable, but it doesn't really, you know, paint a picture of an excited person, really.
There's a few things that,
there are
you
a few
can pick up, like
kind of
the
things.
Call of the hunt on the horns.
That you can absolutely hear.
When she's surprised by the clock movement and her dances in front of the mirror, you can sort of pick up the suggestions in the music.
Right. Okay, so anyway, this starts out with an overture, and right away, it's just super charming. It's got this dancey, kind of Mozart-type theme. Like, it actually sounds a bit like something he would do. It's instantly appealing. I mean, you'll be drawn into this right away. I enjoyed that the brass are used rather heavily in the opening. You often complain that Mozart just doesn't really use the brass much. You just have to like count for like 100 measures and then just kind of play one note for a long time or something, you know. But no, Wranitzky actually employs the brass pretty heavily. He gives them a little bit of a workout for the period anyway. I mean,
This is some an exciting overture. I like the little, it's got these little dropping flute figures in the middle that are very kind of playful. And then it gives you a fake out right about 2 minutes and 40 seconds. The phrase is just clipped and doesn't finish. And then it goes back to the original theme. We've seen that in Wranitzky's music before, little tricks that just kind of make sure you're paying attention.
They kind of draw your attention. You know, they kind of surprise you.
I enjoyed this a lot.
Yeah, and Wranitzky, one of the things he seems to be known for, and I'm really picking this up now too, is his writing for wind instruments. Mm. It really stands out. It's unusual, even for the period. It doesn't really seem to follow the standard practices of, you know, what winds do. Like, he'll isolate them, and they'll often have slightly contrapuntal lines. It's really interesting.
There's a lot of interplay. There's some nice bassoon work throughout this score, too. The bassoon really stands out. We also heard on the previous recordings and then here, too, the flute and oboe sort of playing off from each other in different sections is really nice. Good clarinets in here too. It's a kind of woodwind, real good woodwind exposition all through here.
Well, what I've done here is I've written like Daniel's kind of like summary of the story into my notes, and then I tried to write my notes in, and it all became a big confusing mess.
I was doing something similar. Yeah, so.
So I'm going to tell the story and just make occasional comments on the music. That'll be the approach that I use here. So it's in three acts, and this is the first act starts on track two. In Prince Floreski's castle, the princess arrives, and we get this nice rushing theme that kind of reminded me a little bit of The Marriage of Figaro. It's got that kind of the beginning of Marriage of Figaro, when you hear Figaro singing Cinque Dieci's, measuring the bed and stuff, which is very titillating, of course. But here we have the princess beginning to dress, which I guess would be a similar kind of situation. Anyway, we go on to the next track. The Prince Floreski, that's Princess Floreska's honey, her husband, enters. We hear hunting horns accompanying him, so we know he's ready to go on the hunt. And the princess is worried about him, basically. So let's see. We can hear that Prince Floreski is a real manly type. His entrance music is solid and brass heavy. A lot of lovely winds in this, mostly flutes. He's going to go on the hunt, even though his wife is telling him, oh, it's so dangerous. But anyway, we go on. Let's see. Let's skip ahead to track six. That's a 9-minute musical section. And we're in the forest now. And Azemia, we see her. She's the forest maiden. She's sleeping on a bed of moss, and we hear the gentle theme with rustic tones to indicate her situation. So she's a little more rustic, not terribly refined. She wakes up, says her morning prayer. So she lived in the woods her whole life, but she knows how to pray. That's pretty good. And goes to pick fruit for her breakfast. And then we get a dancier theme, for this part. The hunting party, we know they're approaching when we hear the hunting horns, and Azemia gets worried and hides in a cave. Let's see, Floreski appears, one of their party is Petrushka is chased by a bear and climbs a tree. The other hunters attack the bear, and Prince Levinsky, who is Floreska's brother, arrives and persecutes the bear out of sight. Petrushka comes down from the tree and discovers Azemia in her cave. They both become scared, run away in opposite directions, and Petrushka returns with Prince Floreski and describes how he encountered a spectacular two-legged beast.
This is where there's a really nice cello part in this one.
I said there's a pretty rustic theme sounding on thick-sounding strings. I said perhaps a viola, but it could be a cello in its higher end. I wasn't really sure. There's some good sounds in this whole section. Anyway, the prince is moved by her. This is Floreski, and he tries to inspire her trust. And there's a lot of like little stuff going on, but the main part of the story is that Levinsky sees her, and Floreski explains who she is, and she starts to like Levinsky, and she tells her story. They give her a sleeping potion. Oh, man. She gets roofied for like 200 years before this became a thing. And they carry her off back to the castle. They want to show her, bring her back to civilization. Anyway.
Yeah, the music goes through kind of like a lot of dancing interplay. And then you read that in the score, like she takes a sleeping, and then like, pill? And then you can hear the drowsiness come in the music as it kind of...
Yeah, the music sort of quietens down to end act one. I imagine that is the closing of her eyes to blackness. And then we get the second act on track nine. Here we're in the princess's chamber again, and the chambermaids dance, waiting for the arrival of their mistress. And this is another cheerful musical setting. By the way, Marek Stilek is conducting this with high energy all the way through. This sounds really, you know, like a... an enthusiastic performance. It's really enjoyable. Never slackens in the entire 65 minutes of it. It's really good.
Yeah, they sound really pumped to play this.
Yeah.
The the rhythms have lots of energy.
It comes across as elegant. You know, the parts are well kind of played so that they're easy to kind of pick out. It's just fantastic. So the princess is still worried. The hunting party returns, and the princess is told about the strange find that has been made, and she is moved by the girl's plight and goes to greet everybody. And we get some lively major key bubbling melodies until about a minute and 10 seconds when hesitations in the rhythm indicate the princess's curiosity, I'm guessing. The theater transforms into another room in the castle for track 11. Azemia sleeps on an ottoman in an alcove. She still hasn't recovered from her sleeping draft. And the princes and the princess contemplate her with interest. While she starts stirring, the others hide themselves. I guess they want her to wake up alone. And this has a lovely long-held brass harmony at this point. Let's see, another long section comes in track 12. Azemia is by herself, and she walks around the rooms, and she's surprised. The mirrors, like as you mentioned earlier, astonish her. And there's a carefulness to the rhythm and melody here, as though to indicate caution. And all the material here has a really strong rhythmic profile. That's really true throughout the work, because it is a dance work after all. Her curiosity is piqued by a pendulum clock, and the music here was really charming. There are pizzicati in the bass that indicated to me the swinging of the clock's pendulum. Now, I didn't actually follow the score in this part, so I'm just kind of trying to pull that out from the notes. So I'm hoping that's what that is. It's a really lovely section of the score.
Yeah, I like the bassoon triplets here because they keep that rhythm. But Renitsky uses the bassoon kind of beautifully in some places. But here, I think it gets that sort of playfulness of a... Right. Odd sound because they're, just in using that timbre brings out, you can imagine her dancing around these mirrors and doing silly things, having never seen them before.
It must be a fun thing to watch. I hope somebody will put it on one day. So Azemia expresses her satisfaction, tries to win the favor of the princess by whose kindness and grace she is enthralled. The brass, by the way, at the end of this of track 12 have a lot to do, and it's really kind of exciting too, especially for this period. Those valveless horns at the time, they must have been rough to play actually at the time. Okay, so we go on. There's a little detour from the main story when a dancing master comes in. Monsieur Sisson, as we heard at the beginning, and he has been called to give Azemia more suitable manners, and Azemia finds it difficult to understand the usefulness of this ridiculous figure, and he's given a graceful if slightly pedantic theme. It's kind of more repetitive than usual, and it's careful in its repetitiveness. I guess if they were rewriting this today, the ridiculous character would probably be a podcaster like ourselves. So dancing, we are the dancing masters of modern times. Anyway,
we have to get you a wig to do that part.
Yeah, I could use a wig. Anyway, she gets a lesson. She gets bored. She starts. She gives into outbreaks of wildness. The dancing master gets exasperated with her, but then Levinsky comes in and teaches her to dance with kindness and love, and she responds to that, and the dancing master leaves in a huff. Anyway, Azemia admires the beautiful dress of the princess and wants a similar gown, and this is promised to her. And a ball is arranged, and that brings us to the third act, which takes place in a ballroom, starting from track 15. There are a lot of dances here. There's a lot of lovely detail in this whole section, by the way. There are a string of dances so people can show off. And Azemia arrives in a splendid Polish costume, and everybody says how beautiful she is. And Levinsky's admiration has constantly been growing, remarks that a bit more nobility would raise her charms even further. And she, of course, scoffs at him, but tries to mimic the noble grace of the princesses must be amusing to watch for the audience of the time, who were probably all nobles themselves. The rhythm becomes fleeter and lighter here, and Levinsky can no longer suppress his passion. He goes for it, declares his love, and then the musicians begin the Russian dance. Levinsky seizes the opportunity to profess his feelings. This is rather a rustic-sounding dance. It's elegant, with rough accented chords occasionally heard in the strings. The ball continues with a Polish dance. This track continues with the ternary form dances. There are a lot of these ABA sort of structures to these dances. There'd be like this. There'll be a dance to one dance sandwiching like a middle, like more elegant dance. In this, the princess gives a necklace to Azemia, and Azemia wants to return the gesture, and she produces a medallion, which apparently was given to her before she went into the forest. She gives it to the princess, and she explains it's her most treasured possession because she's had it since her earliest childhood. The medallion springs open when the princess is looking at it, and there's a miniature painting inside, which discloses that Azemia is a princess of the House of Floreski, abducted in her childhood. Oh, she's part of the family. She's not even just a noble.
Yeah.
Okay. It stops after we get... This is... I'm kind of talking about this lightly, but most stories of the period were kind of like this. There was a lot of coincidental events happening in a lot of these stories of the time. If you watch a lot of or listen to a lot of early opera, too, this happens a lot. People find out they're really brother and sister, you know, or things like that. Kind of like Star Wars, right? Princess Leia and Luke. It just keeps going on. Let's see. The bassoon comes back here in track 18. Creative orchestration here by Reniski. I like the... There was some playing on the bridge of the strings on track 19 at the beginning of 230, so it gets that sort of like... So not full sound. It's kind of ghostly. It's got a scrapey sort of sound. Mm. And that quickly changes to the full string sound. It kind of like sort of... thickens as they move away, as the bows move away from the bridge. Nice effect there. I should have checked the score and seen what the indication was for that.
I really like this track a lot. Yeah, when the strings get full, it really envelops you with the sound on here.
Yeah, it was a nice effect. I'm wondering if that was Renitsky's or Marek's. effect. Anyway, there's a variation on the dance we've heard. Everybody's happy, and Levinsky requests Azemia's hand after seeing the painting, the miniature painting inside the medallion, and Azemia agrees to marry him. Their happiness, their forthcoming betrothal, are celebrated by the court. A very energetic and brief section indicates that we have a happy ending, and we as the listeners are as elated as Prince Levinsky and Azemia are. This is a lovely score full of simple yet appealing ideas and lovely and occasionally ear-catching, intriguing details. Actually, there are quite a lot of ear-catching, intriguing details. And that's also thanks to Marek Stilek for drawing those details out. This is sure to charm the listener. It's not as... symphonies aren't really complicated, but this isn't as complicated as... let's say a symphony. The themes don't develop. They're really kind of more... There are a lot of ABA forms, ternary forms. And the music is very simple. So we get to hear Renitsky's melodic and orchestral invention here more than any sort of harmonic development. You know, it's a dance piece, so it's really not going to go for the intellect too much. They want you watching what's on the stage. But we could hear that he's got great melodic ideas and a lot of fantastic orchestral ideas too, particularly with the winds and the brass. I was really impressed by this. Really good piece.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Right. The rhythmic movements constantly changing. If you look at the score and you'll see when there's a scene change or something, he'll change the key there too. So you'll suddenly be in a new key, which sort of matches the idea that now you're going to have a different background and sort of cleanse the visual palette of what you're seeing for the story. So you can imagine how that would work together. And as you said, the choice of instruments and the interplay really brings out, the special timbres of especially the wind instruments, along with the story. And then the constant motion, the meters are always changing. That's what impressed me a lot, you know, from one dance to another, and then you're in cut time, then you're in three-quarter time. The motion is constantly changing. And even though, as you say, compositionally.
Yeah, and the textures as well, even when we stick to like that 3/4 time. He'll often like reorchestrate too, like a melody. Like you'll have like the two halves of a melody, and then you'll hear it again, and sections of the melody will be reorchestrated each time you hear them. It's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
It was really, my ear was constantly drawn in by that as well. Okay, let's go on to the last work on this. This is a track 22, A Pastorale en Allemande. This is a separate work. This was found in Empress Marie Therese's collection. Hronitzky was one of her favorite composers. This work in the A section, it's again a ternary form, A-B-A, and the outer sections imitate the sound of a hurdy-gurdy. And there's a danceable Allemande in the B section. Now, a hurdy-gurdy, you can go to YouTube and see what that looks like. It's kind of like this giant sort of viola-looking thing. It's kind of, in size, it's somewhere between a viola and a cello. And you can, I guess you hold it on your lap and you crank it. And you can change the tones it's playing by these buttons that are on the side of it. I kind of, and it, the thing about it is, because you crank it, it's constantly legato. There's no real kind of breath or pause. So this, it's not quite a mechanical sound, but it kind of is, you know, close to that. You know, the cranking of it kind of makes it sound like, you know, like it's not breathing, like it's kind of like some kind of machine. It's a pretty intriguing sound, though. And gets a constant legato in its changing notes. Here, Marek Stilek provides a deep outline of the rhythm of the hurdy-gurdy section. I mean, there's no doubt that this is what's being imitated here. It comes across as a rustic dance. The hurdy-gurdy sounds very rustic. In fact, is. They're kind of easy to play. So, they were good for, you know, village dances, I guess, back in the day. And that's what we hear here. The orchestra is, his interpretation is well characterized. He gets a vibrato-less and droning quality to the orchestra. Now, remember, they're imitating this instrument. They are not mechanical themselves, but they're imitating this sound quite well. The Allemande starts at 2 minutes and 21 seconds. It's pretty easy to spot because there's a pause before it. And it's pretty fast for an Allemande. I'm judging by the speeds that the Bach's Allemandes are played by in the Baroque era settings. It glides along satisfyingly, and after a pause, the hurdy-gurdy comes back at 5 minutes and 7 seconds, so another charming, pastoral-sounding piece. All in all, a real winner. Between this and the third kind of installment in the Naxos series, it's kind of hard to judge. I kind of like the symphonies better just because there's more kind of harmonic ideas happening in them, but the creativity in this really kind of drew me in too. I enjoyed this a lot. Thumbs up for this. Give it a listen. It's just a really happy recording all around, and you know, should cheer you up on a rainy day.
Yeah, it's really packed with energy. The orchestra sounds really confident and full sounding. The rhythms are tight and they move along with great energy, and Marek's conducting is really precise. It hits all the changes in the program. So much so that if you follow the score and read, you can imagine what's happening.
Right.
And you know, he has to be aware of all of these things that would be going on as well. So I thought, you know, that's a really good job of stitching all these themes together that have to work around this story. So the playing and conducting is great, and the sonics are fabulous on this recording.
It's super
clear. You can hear everything, and it's very balanced as well.
And Marek Stilek also, he's really good at drawing out the idiosyncrasies of the score. Like if there's like a dissonance, he'll give it a slight accent to make sure that it stands out and that you hear it.
Yeah.
You know, he doesn't just kind of play over them as we sometimes hear. I think he really likes this score. It just sounds like everybody's enjoying themselves.
Sounds like they're all having fun.
All right. So a winner in Renitsky releases.
So you've got four of those, and you've also got the Oboe Works, which we did a few weeks back. You can check out. And then if you haven't heard our interview, check out interview 3 on Adult Music if you want to hear Merrick's comments on Renitsky works, and also Daniel Bernardson's background and more insight there. And as I said, check out the link to the Renitsky project to get some more information about other upcoming recordings.
Yeah, I think there's one coming, you said, on Harmonia Mundi pretty soon. Is
yeah,
that right?
It's out.
It's
yeah,
out. So. Okay, it's not on a CD, though, is it?
It wasn't available yet last time I checked. But
yeah, this yeah. just drives me crazy. I'm just a big CD fan. I mean, I'll listen to it on the streaming, but still, I like to sit in front of the stereo. Okay, next we have one of Renitsky's pals, Ludwig van Beethoven. You might have heard of him. We have a new recording of Violin Sonatas by Beethoven. These are sonatas number 1 in D major, opus 12, number 1. The famous number 5 in F major, the Spring Sonata. I was kind of glad that was on here. I kind of wanted to hear that again. Appropriate for this time of year. And the very last of the violin sonatas, number 10 in G major, opus 96. These are played by one of my favorite violinists, Rachel Podger, on violin, and she's playing with, I'm not going to say accompanied by, because Beethoven's violin sonatas, the piano is very much an equal partner here. Christopher Glynn on an Erard forte piano from 1840. So after Beethoven died, really. Beethoven died in 1827, so this piano was manufactured after his death. This is on the Channel Classics label, and it's an SACD. So I got that extra dimension this week. I was kind of happy about that. I've got a few of those coming up, actually. There's one next week, too. Anyway, I was kind of curious to hear this. I had gone through Podger's Mozart series, and this is the first release in what I'm guessing is going to be a traversal of the complete all 10 violin sonatas. I doubt they'll only do these, and one would hope not anyway. Anyway, we start with Violin Sonata number 1 in D major, opus 12, number 1. First movement starts Allegro con brio, right? So it's going to be energetic, but it starts pretty slowly, surprisingly, with a thick violin sound and rather light piano. The Erard is kind of does have a light sound. When you listen to this piano, by the way, you want to try to imagine Chopin's piano music, because he favored the Erard piano. And his playing at the salons would have sounded something like this, but he wouldn't have played Beethoven because he hated everyone except Mozart and Bach.
I actually thought the piano recording is done really well on this recording. It's clear, and there's, we often comment that we don't like the piano sound on some recordings. I thought they got just enough room sound. In here.
Yeah.
So it wasn't too dry or close, and it didn't have, get lost in sort of a reverb-y thing. Just enough to create a sense of space while you could still hear all the tones of the piano clearly. I thought that was captured really well.
Right. The first movement here, it sounded a bit more subdued than most performances do of this first movement. Mm-hmm. The piano sound is very pretty, I said. It's sort of like a light version of a modern piano. Mm. And as is the case in all of these sonatas, the piano is an equal partner with the violin, as I mentioned, and has a lot of heavy playing to do on its own without the violin.
Right. But like I say, overall, I thought it's kind of a light but stately presentation of Beethoven. Sometimes, people can inject maybe a little bit too much heaviness into these kind of works, but not the case.
And this is an early work too, so it's like, I think, from around 1798 or so. This performance brings out the classical Mozartian elements of the work and underplays the Beethovenian touches, like the Sforzati and stuff like that, which are there, but they're not quite in full Beethoven mode yet. The period instruments do reveal some pretty detail and quieter passages, and I like the way Podger varies the sound on elements that repeat each time we hear them. She takes the repeat at the beginning and varies her touch and her approach, and it just keeps the ear engaged. I really love it when musicians do that. You already have this highly detailed music, and now you're getting, you know, a different angle of it. All right, second movement, Tema con Variazioni, Andante con Moto. The piano plays the opening by itself and has a bit of a rattle to some of its strings when it plays it. Poggio then joins in and plays the thematic melody. The first variation, the piano pretty much takes the lead as the violin does filigree work to accompany. The violin gets the lead in the next variation. And I like the way Poggio varies her tone for expression. Again, the piano sets a very deliberate rhythm in this variation and accents the bass notes in a reassuring way. One of the things I liked about Christopher Glynn's playing is that he's paying attention to the beat, let's say. We're very aware of where the beat is landing. He's not just kind of it's not becoming sort of like a sort of the word that's coming to me is ghostly, but that's not really what I want to say. It doesn't just kind of glide through it, you know, where you don't know where the downbeat is. He lands on it well enough that we can always tell where it is. So we get more of a sense of like this liveliness, this kind of brio to his playing. Yeah, we can hear the echo of the bass notes in the violin's material. The next variation is a bit more aggressive, and how can we not hear that from Beethoven? The following one contrasts by being played quietly, and the violin sighs out its material here. Very nice. Ends quietly. Third movement, we get a lovely rondo theme. It's lively and dancey, and as I mentioned, Glynn really pulls out the rhythmic profile very strongly, so that makes this really enjoyable. The duo are excellent at setting these rhythms so that we have a sense of beat and motion. This is a bit fast for this movement, I thought. So I thought the first movement was slow, and this one's a little faster. They're trying to go for some new sort of interpretation here, I guess. It sounds actually more appropriate played this way than slightly slower. I liked this rondo section a lot. The episodes tend to be more emotional, and I enjoyed Poggio's emoting on some of the phrases, whereas once we get back to the rondo theme, it's always kind of dancey and happy again, you know. She stretches out the melody slightly for effect before a pause sometimes. She's got a lot of tonal colors, and she uses them judiciously. This is why I've enjoyed her playing for so many years. And Glynn's sense of rhythm helps make this very appealing. All right, onward to the very famous Spring Sonata, Violin Sonata number 5 in F major, Opus 24. In the Allegro, this famous melody is taken quite fast. It's usually just sort of relaxed, and you just kind of feel like you're walking around with the breeze on you on this pleasant spring day. But she takes this pretty fast, does Rachel Poggio. Her tone is light, as is Glynn's. I guess the fleetness possible on the Erard is being taken advantage of. It's a lighter action. And this is a really interesting thing. The Erard piano, and there was another type of piano that were sort of in competition with each other of the time, and different composers favored the different pianos. And I think the Erard won, the one that Chopin used, because people like Mendelssohn and Hummel used a lighter actioned piano, and that made their works harder to play on a heavier action, and that's probably why we don't hear them as often these days. So the instrument you choose, it's a crapshoot too. Anyway, there's a beautiful sense of balance in this movement. It's maintained in the fleeter, more dramatic passages, such as when the piano races up the scale and the violin takes the scale back down. There's a neat transition into the repeat of the opening material just after 2:25. And again, the approach is different in the repeat. I love that. It makes it so interesting. It sounds like the second time around, it sounds more assured and confident, whereas the first time it sounded more like we were discovering something new. Like, you know, there's like a path, and then the path has gotten more worn, and it's kind of played with more confidence the second time. At around 4:40, the development is launched into without a pause. It's fairly brief and bold. The recapitulation comes just after 5:30, so it's a very short development. And it sounds lighter after the development material, and also fast like the beginning. It's elegantly played throughout with a keen ear for detail. The rougher passages don't come across so roughly. These musicians aren't really trying to bring out those elements so much. Second movement, Adagio Molto Espressivo. The piano begins with its romantic sounding melody. The violin adds some atmosphere, very quietly here. I'm really surprised at how well the Erard registers the melody of this particular movement. I thought its light sort of sound would kind of, you wouldn't get the legato necessary, but no. I could imagine what Chopin would have sounded like on one of these. The violin picks up the melody in the next go-around with no vibrato, but Podger is still sensitive in her playing. She does a kind of a subtle tapering of the sound to draw out expression. It's really nice. A subtle effect. The Erard has a pretty impressive booming bass note at 1 minute and 50 seconds. And the material repeats with lots more ornaments this time. Very noticeable since Beethoven gives them accents in the score. And the trills at the end of the movement are also very quickly taken. Third movement, Scherzo, is fairly brief. It's got a jumpy melody with lots of sforzares, so, you know, these sort of accents off the beat. And those are played rather quietly. I mean, they're noticeable, but they're not accented strongly. It doesn't sound like you're kind of in a car speeding over a speed bump, as a lot of performances do. They go over them a little more carefully. The middle section features fast scales, and again, ideal balance is maintained. Fourth movement, Rondo, and we get a real pastoral rondo here, a woodsy one. This is very quickly taken also, and all details register nicely. The two breathe nicely together and have good balance throughout, particularly in the departure from the rondo theme, when the piano has a lot of repeated notes under the violin's theme. This is played pretty uniformly. The approach works well. You get a good sense of how the movement is shaped. They pay attention to the form. After about 4 minutes and 45 seconds, or rather they outline the form well, I should say, for the listener, so that the listener will notice it. After 4 minutes and 45 seconds, the maintaining of the rhythmic profile at speed is very impressive. These two highlight the rhythm exceptionally well. Finally, we get to the final violin sonata, and Beethoven's last violin sonata, which he wrote in his heroic period around the time of the Fifth Symphony. This was he would live another, oh boy, like 20 years almost, and wouldn't write another violin sonata. I always find that interesting. Anyway, this has a very long first movement, mostly because it's got a repeat that's a long exposition that where there a repeat is taken, so it takes up quite a lot of time. Here in this movement, the first movement, Podger has a sweet tone at the beginning with its opening in the higher register of the instrument. The piano sets a steady rhythm, especially in the second theme. We get a sense of being on the waves with the 6-8 rhythm and some nice transitions by Podger as she plays one chord just past the 1 minute and 30 second mark with a slight accent and discordant sound that draws attention to the change of character of the material. I really love it when soloists act as a guide to the music for the listeners, and she's really good at that. The repeat is taken, and that makes this a fairly long movement. Variations in tone and attack are heard, keeping things interesting. That's true throughout this entire album, despite the same material. The transition to the development section happens just after the 5-minute mark. It's very subtle, a key change to the minor that goes barely registered. It's a quick development section as the recapitulation returns after only a minute or so of development. Podger takes the double-stopped transition more smoothly this time. Interesting because there isn't a key change here. It's a nice idea. I mean the transition to the second theme in the recapitulation, by the way. There isn't a key change here, so it's all in the same key now, because the second theme changes to the main key as opposed to being in a different key at the beginning. It's a nice idea. At 8 minutes and 50 seconds, a coda begins with stray themes we've heard before put together, leading to the final cadence. Second movement, Adagio Espressivo. The piano gets a long chordal introduction, which is then repeated more sensitively with the violin playing now a melody and now accompaniment. Podger here doesn't have a particularly beautiful tone, but it's lyrical and expressive. I mean, she's doing this on purpose. I don't mean to say she doesn't have a beautiful tone. And I prefer her lyrical and expressive tone, actually, but I'll take the beautiful tone, too. The material doesn't stray far from its initial setting. The movement is song-like and brief at 5 minutes and 38 seconds. Third movement scherzo, just as the adagio is about to resolve to its cadence, it explodes into this movement. So this, the first chord of this movement acts as the resolve for the second movement. The rhythmic profile picks up a lot, and the players make sure you notice that. The middle section is more lyrical and dance-like. The opening material, a more deranged dance, returns for the last section. The fourth movement, Poco Allegretto, is a longish movement, 8 minutes or so, that opens with a folk-like melody. Podger throws in a lot of slightly undertuned tones to her accompaniment to draw the ear and add a rustic feel, which is appropriate and bold. We get a bolder variation next, with the piano hammering out three quick chords that the violin plays over. This seems a set of variations to me. The next one features the piano playing scalar material as the violin plays the melody. This particular section is ternary, and after the repeat of its quick chordal material, it goes to a gentler section where the piano plays a melody and the violin adds filigree. I've already lost track of what I'm talking about. I have to hear this piece to know. Give it a listen so that, you know, maybe you can follow along that way. This gets traded off for the next go-around. I like the violin's steady, almost bagpipe-like held tones as the piano plays the melodic material. We get a brief folk-like theme. Then the material starts moving at relatively high speed as the duo trade off melodic and accompanying duties. There's a nice flourish by the violin towards the end, then the piano, and that ends the sections. We get a brief slow coda at the end to bring us to the final cadence, to which there's a sudden rush of energy. I must have been kind of on my second drink by then or something. All right. These are interesting recordings of these works. Not just the period sounds of the instruments, but the fresh sound, unromanticized interpretations make this recording draw the ear and puzzle over whether everything is there. Rest assured, it is, and more. I especially enjoyed hearing the rhythm of each movement thrown into high relief. Rhythm is important in Beethoven, even when it's straightforward, and I'm looking forward to hearing the rest of this series. I liked this a lot. 2 for 2 tonight. With Ranitzky and Beethoven.
Yeah, I enjoyed this one too. I always like Podger because I like her tone, and I can't say that of all violinists. Sometimes I get I get fatigued from
She has more of a thicker kind of like broad tone, and it's got a nice kind of color to it, you know.
Yeah, so I liked that, and as I said, I liked the way the piano was recorded, and it worked well with her sound. So I was hooked in from the tonal qualities from the beginning, and then I just like the approach to Beethoven. As you say, it's not kind of indulgent or overdone approach, but I thought it was stately and nuanced. As you said, she brings a lot of extra kind of variation. When there's repeated material, an attention to detail that's really nice. I liked the emphasis on rhythm and precision.
Yeah, I like that too.
And the way they're really locked together. And I just thought overall a kind of classy performance that it doesn't wear you out. It keeps drawing you in and keeps you interested to the end. And there's some nice little subtle details in the performance that make it unique. And I'd like to hear more of this series.
These really overplayed works come up sounding fresh here. That's really the highest compliment, I'd say.
Very nice.
All right, on to the last recording. I always try to include a contemporary work. This one sadly isn't quite contemporary. It's Johann Johansson. He was an Icelandic composer, born in 1969, making him 4 years younger than me, and tragically died in 2018. Wow. He at the age of 48, the likely cause of death being a lethal combination of cocaine and flu medication. Well, I guess he died like a rock star.
Wow. At least he didn't freeze to death.
Anyway, this is the recording of his Drone Mass, and this is really making the rounds. It's getting quite a bit of press, this recording. It's performed by the American Contemporary Music Ensemble, whose abbreviation is ACME. bringing up images of Wile E. Coyote.
Yeah.
And Theater of Voices, conducted by Paul Hillier. So they're
everything
well
of
known.
The description of this is very bizarre. So,
what do you mean?
You know, Drone Mass, Iceland, Acme. I kind of like wondered what you'd gotten us into with this one. But I have to say, I ended up really enjoying this a lot more than I expected to.
I liked it a lot, too. I should mention it's released by Deutsche Grammophon, so good for them for championing.
Taking a chance on this.
Yeah, just sort of contemporary or close to contemporary composers. Okay. All right, this I think this may have been the... let me tell you a little about Johansson. He was Icelandic, as I mentioned, and he wrote music for a wide variety of media, including theater, dance, television, and films. I think he was best known as a film composer. He blends traditional orchestration with contemporary electronic elements, and that's exactly what we're going to get in this piece. He's still being mourned by the classical community. His compositional voice is considered a great loss. And this piece is one of the reasons why, too, because it's... getting a lot of attention. The Drone Mass is an electroacoustic oratorio. An oratorio is like a...
Of course it is.
Yeah, of course. Because of course it is. An oratorio is a... it's an unstaged opera, basically. Okay, so the singers... There's a story being told, and the singers aren't in costume or anything. They're just standing and singing. So think of Handel's Messiah. That's an oratorio. It tells a story, but... It's a concert work. This piece can be seen as an exercise in what he calls... I learned a new word this week. Apophenia, which is the tendency of the human brain to draw connections between apparently unrelated things, to find patterns and meanings where none was intended. And if you just get on the internet and look at any political post, you'll probably see lots of this. I'm actually really good at this, but I try to do it in books and not in coming up with conspiracy theories like most people do. Anyway, this particular work was inspired by the musical concept of the drone, but also of flying drones currently used in warfare. So this is an example of this apophenia. Mm-hmm. So the drone bass, which is just keeps going. I think of Tibetan monks there. Mm-hmm. And also... We call these flying death machines or delivery machines that Jeff Bezos wants to use for Amazon. Drones. Can you imagine one of those things at your door delivering your package? I don't know. I think I'd be terrified.
Have you ever flown one?
I never have flown one. I've seen them, though. People
I got to
fly them around.
A funny story. I bought one for my nephew.
Yeah.
And, of course, I wanted to try it out, too. And so I said, let's see how high it can go. So I got it way up in the sky. And upon descent, I snagged it in a tree. And then,
like a kite.
Then I tried to get it free by rapidly, moving forward and reversing the propellers to cut through the leaves. And I ended up burning out the engines. We had to get out of the tree, which my nephew said, thanks, Uncle Russ. I broke his present.
That's what happens when
I felt so bad. I got another one and I sent it from Japan to him, you know. So.
Oh, cool.
Anyway, right. That was my drone experience.
You kind of owed it to him there. the thing about drones that when I saw them, there was somebody at the university flying one once. And I was looking up at this thing and I'm saying, you know, if this thing just suddenly loses power, it's just going to come crashing down on someone's head. Yeah, it's really scary.
When they start to drop, they really drop. So
yeah, they're heavy.
Yeah, yeah,
they're kind of big. I don't know. I think it's kind of a crazy thing. I could see why flying cars aren't really a good idea.
No, George Jetson yet.
Yeah, no, but they'll just come crashing down on people. Yeah. You know. All right, back to the Drone Mass. So the work searches for unexpected connections between the texts. Of the ancient Nag Hammadi scriptures, written in Coptic, I believe. And I'm not sure if that's true, actually. Anyway, never mind. And the sounds we hear are all sung in Coptic. I know that. Mm. And the distorted views of reality in the digital age. Oh, you think?
No.
Between the vocal polyphony of the Renaissance and the alien effects of Ableton software. A lot of people use this. A lot of music people use Ableton software. I've never used it myself. I'm not really sure what it is, but it manipulates sound in some way. I think DJs use it too, more record producers. And also between the beatific or malevolent eye that watches us from above. This reminded me of Sauron in The Lord of the Rings. Okay. He says whether God or machine, so that either God is watching us or a drone is spying on us. In other words, he's trying to make these connections. And the long-held tones that paradoxically both ground a piece of music and enable it to take flight. This piece is not a setting of the mass, so we shouldn't think of it that way, though it does have religious texts in it that we don't understand because no texts are provided in the booklet note, and nor does he really want us to know what the words mean. As I said, they're sung in Coptic, and we can just guess that there's some sort of spiritual message.
So it all becomes cryptic.
Yeah, I think it is anyway.
Yeah.
Nor is it a piece that simply drones, although I thought drones were present. Okay, they're a recurring motif through the work. Acme's director, Clarice Jensen, says the piece feels like holy minimalism. Think Arvo Pärt, John Tavener, and Henrik Goretzky, whose music kind of suspends time and repeats quite a lot. I thought there was a little Philip Glass in this too, actually.
A lot of concepts going on.
Yeah, there's a lot
into this.
And it's a fairly pleasant listen, to be honest. It throws up a few challenges, but
yeah, you know, it contains enough of traditional Western music harmony and then sort of development to give you something to hold on to. And while it does shock in some places, it also satisfies a lot in others. So it sort of balances out expectation
and surprise, really, yeah,
with surprise and also some quite disturbing things too. So you get it all in one.
I didn't really find it disturbing, but we'll
there's
get
just
into
a
that
couple things that disturbed me. When we get to it,
yeah. Point them out when they're there, because I don't know. I guess I listened to too much Harrison Burt Whistle to ever be disturbed by a piece of music again. rest in peace, sir. Anyway, the drone mask. This guy too. God. The drone mask calls for a string quartet, 8 voices, and electronics. Let's see. So we start. It's a 9-movement work, and all the movements have titles. The first one is called One is True. And this starts out sounding like the beginning of a Renaissance mass with the word. It sounds to me like they're saying Kyrie here, which is Greek. But he says it's Coptic. I don't know. I got to take his word for it. Kyrie is Lord, okay? So if that's what they're saying. Beautifully sung melisma here. Gorgeous vocal quality. Theater of Voices have made many recordings, and we expect this from them. There's a contrapuntal line in the lower women's voices. The men's voices are droning, and something more modern erupts from that with a thumping bass from the men while the women continue their melisma. An electronic droning sound fades in, and the women's voices become less distinct. There's a lot of this fading, and I get the impression this is being done in a mixing console. Although the when the voices kind of go down, I think they fade naturally on their own. We can hear violins playing a contrasting line to the vocals. There are plucked strings in the mix, as well as at the end. Okay, the movement is a gradual build-up to a forte, and by the end there's a thumping rhythm, contemporary meets Renaissance. So he's built a bridge from that ancient era to the present day. Second, 2 is apocryphal. That's the title of the second movement. There's a long pause before this movement starts, or I should say section. I shouldn't say movement here. It starts with gorgeous, quiet choral singing, both men and women, all singing in harmony, so that there aren't any contrapuntal lines at this point. A soaring high woman's voice comes in, which kind of reminded me a bit of the high voice in Allegri's Miserere. give that a listen on your streaming service. And it sounds really gentle. The rhythm gently rocks back and forth. This reminded me a little bit of Goretzky, really. There are vibrato-less strings under the voices, imitating them, the voices. The high woman's voice comes in again, quietly soaring. The movement lulls one into a contemplative state. And there you are in that contemplative state. And the third movement starts. Triptych in mass. This starts with an aggressive cello drone. It may be tempered by electronics. I wasn't really sure. There are string sounds bowing on harmonics. I always love that sound. The men's voices come in a scattered harmony, entering at different times. Singing in harmony, however. This is appealing, but a bit more aggressive in its presentation. Each movement has been longer than the previous so far. This one clocks in at 5 minutes 52 seconds. Women's voices begin to be heard intoning three syllables. A swirling electronics effect becomes more audible. There are a lot of slow crescendos in this work. This all fades, and a transition to an ostinato string line emerges, sounding very minimalist, like Philip Glass or Henrik Goretzky. There's an octave, it doesn't sound like them, but it just kind of made me think of them. There's an octave harmony between bass instrument and a woman's voice. The men's chorus comes in with three-syllable enunciations, and this ends on a fade with the ostinato string line stopping on its last note. Fourth section, to fold and remain dormant. This movement is shorter. At 4 minutes 31 seconds, it starts with an electronic wind sound with a bit of rattling distortion in it, like something being scraped. I was kind of wondering what this would sound like in headphones. I listened to it on speakers.
I described it as a an idling engine through exhaust pipes.
So did you hear this on headphones? Or?
Yes, I did, yeah.
Okay, that's probably why. I was thinking, I bet this is kind of pretty harsh sounding on headphones. I should probably listen to it that way.
It's interesting. You get that kind of muffled sound at the end, but there's something rattling up further, like the manifold has got a rattle or something. Right. Very interesting electronic sound. Yeah,
there's some deep bass sound making its presence felt at 1 minute, and that really was a chest cavity sort of feeling. This is an electronics heavy movement. What sounds like a crackling live wire drones on as the choral voices fade in and out. And they do this naturally. This isn't like a mixing console.
Yeah, they float through like waves on this one.
Yeah, that takes a lot of skill, too. It's pretty impressive singing. The electronics fade at the end, and we're hearing electronically altered harmonies at the end, perhaps from the voices as the movement fades. Fifth section, Divine Objects. This is the longest movement yet at 7 minutes, and it starts with a solo violin high up in its register. It's pale sounding and vibrato-less and plays an ostinato figure. Ostinato is a repeating figure. Think of any rock and roll bass line. A lower string instrument, the cello, plays a vibrato-less melody of long-held tones, and both are electronically altered a bit. They sound slicker than usual. There's a lot of holy minimalism here of the Goretzky or Arvo Pärt sort. This section ends at 2 minutes and 45 seconds. There's a pause, and the entire texture comes back with women's voices singing quietly in harmony. It's very pretty. The voices gradually crescendo. Gradual is a key word in describing how this piece moves. Everything moves very slowly, and you almost don't notice it happening. But it's, so it kind of creeps up on you, really. So the crescendo happens gradually until the voices are up front in the audio field. Track 6, the low drone of circulating blood diminishes with time. This title put me off, and the movement itself kind of sounds like that too. This starts with electronics and a distorted rattling sound electronically produced. Siren-like rising sounds dominate. They're mildly disturbing. But I didn't find this off-putting. It contrasts with what we've heard already. 7, Moral Vacuums. Some title. Boy. It's like the world we live in.
Is that
moral
like
vacuum.
A holy what? Hoover? Or...
No, the unholy Hoover. No, the holy Hoover, yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
It's popped in my brain. Gotta give Russ credit for that. The holy Hoover. Nice. All right, this movement starts with scattered entries from the women's voices and a high string sound, which is an altered violin. It's vibratoless, very quiet and gentle, and sounds soothing after the previous movement. The men's chorus comes in at some point, and the entire vocal ensemble singing in harmony gradually crescendo until they're the dominant sound. There are repeating string figures accompanying them. It reminds me of those old Renaissance paintings of cherubs playing violas. You know, I kind of always imagined the sound would sound like this. Like, it would be vibratoless, it would be a little rough, you know, because they're little cherubs, they're kids, you know. There are electronic gurglings to be heard, too. Mm. By the end, the voices have begun to decrescendo and fade out again. Only the women's voices remain at the end. Section 8, Take the Night Air. Don't mind if I do. This has electronics fading in with altered soprano voices or electronics sounding like them. There are human female voices punctuating the texture with a rising staccato vocal line. The electronics grow louder and more distorted as the piece moves on, and men's voices are soon heard with the women's singing the same upward-moving staccato line. Last section, the mountain view, the majesty of the snow-clad peaks from a place of contemplation and reflection. Now, from that title, you think this is going to be like a New Age-sounding movement. It's the longest movement in the piece, and it begins with the choral voices, both men and women, putting together harmonic sounds like they're building blocks. There's a lot of bending downwards of the notes being sung, so they kind of like, you know, swooping kind of sounds. And I'm wondering if it's a natural effect produced by the singers or an effect produced by electronics on the voices. I'm not really sure. We do hear a lot of downward bending electronics in this movement. The entire droning texture fades, and there are downward bending siren-like electronic string sounds. In the viola and cello range, there are electronic string sounds. Vocals come back and continue as before over this new electronic texture. The electronics drop out at one point, and we're left with just the voices singing their striking harmonies on syllabic sounds. That's a really beautiful moment when the electronics suddenly disappear. I really enjoyed that. The electronic strings come back and start diving into lower frequencies under the voices again. All in all, it's a meditative movement and really a meditative piece, though with disturbances. So that's the end of the work, and I thought this was a moving piece and a satisfying one. It had an effect on me. It moved me a bit. It's ideal for when one needs to calm down. So it's meditative as well. I think hearing it lowered my heart rate. So that's good. I could have done listen to this or take an ashwagandha. I chose this one. It's very beautiful in parts, and there are a lot of those parts. I tend to hear electronics as some voice from beyond. In works like these, something divine, not of this world. You can't really put your finger on it. You can't like grasp it. It's not tangible, even though they're disturbing. I think that that's what those forces would seem like to us. Think about Rainer Maria Rilke's angels in the Duino elegies, right? They're kind of a little terrifying. Mm-hmm. I would enjoy hearing this piece live. It must be quite an experience. Anyway. Yeah, it's a little adventurous, but I would recommend this too. And I was very happy with all three classical recordings that we listened to this week.
I like this one a lot more than I thought I would. I just thought it was going to be weird because of the title and all these descriptions. And then I'm not a fan of, you know, mixing electronics with classical music for sure, and less and less in jazz too. But somehow in here, it was an intriguing combination. And what pulled it through to me is, as you said, the beautiful parts are extremely beautiful.
Yeah.
Some of the sort of intervals and angelic-like female voices are really... Yeah, they're really wonderful in here. The disturbing ones are these kind of repeating, dropping pitches. I think the one that the one is The Last Foul Wind I Ever Knew. That one, it has these lower male voices that have these falling, trading, intervals between them. It started to make me get like car sick when I was listening to those a little bit.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So that one was, you know, kind of really disturbing. But, you know, I made up for that. I think maybe the prettiest one was Divine Objects Part 2. It develops this kind of almost folky pentatonic theme in the female voices. And just a layer of tones in their voices is really beautiful. So there's these really shining little lights of kind of pure, beautiful sound in there, too.
You know, I need to mention, I think the reason you found this piece more disturbing than I did was because you heard movements that I didn't hear, because I'm now on Deezer, and there are 9 tracks on the CD, which I listened to, and Deezer has 11 tracks, and there are 2 extra sections. I hadn't heard that one, so who knew? Usually it's the other way around. The CD gets the extra tracks, but not in this
Deezer
case.
Deezer has tracks that aren't on the CD. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which is really strange.
Right.
Divine Objects is in 2 parts. Well,
right.
That
yeah,
might
part
be.
Part 1 and part 2.
Let me just take a look at this. What I have here. Divine Objects. Oh, yeah. They combine them on the CD. So I heard everything you heard except that one movement, the last foul wind I ever knew.
Oh.
It's just the I missed the disturbing stuff.
Oh, yeah. That was
the most disturbing.
And the last one.
Unless it's. Wait, let me see. Unless it's included. Nah, it's not. Hmm. Unless. Movement 4, to fold and remain dormant is like, yeah, it's not. Hmm. Wait. That's odd. Yeah, it's missing from the CD. That's odd.
That's weird. Yeah, usually it's the other way around. Deezer is quite good, but I have found a few recordings where there's something missing or out of order, and I usually report it to them.
That's really weird. I wonder, because it's short enough. I mean, they could have easily put it in.
Huh.
I wonder if it's somehow incorporated, like, as part of another movement. Let me see. I just want to see. The Triptych Mass, it doesn't say. Okay. I don't know.
Well,
anyway.
There you go. An anomaly.
It's a mystery.
Yeah, a mystery.
An anomaly. I wonder why they did that. I'm disturbed now.
it's pretty interesting. When you're in a mood for something a little bit different, this was an interesting hour spent with unexpected sounds, sometimes soothing and sometimes surprising.
Yeah. All right.
Interesting classical week.
It was an interesting. And next week will be an interesting classical week as well.
And moving on to jazz, I've got a solitary theme for this episode. Mallet maestros, hitting things with sticks to make interesting sounds. Mike and I are both fans of vibraphone, an instrument that at one time was quite popular in jazz, featured a lot. We've done a few vibraphone recordings on adult music. But, you know, in recent years, we haven't heard a lot of vibes, but it sounds like it's getting a resurgence. And on my list of recordings, had a number of vibraphone things showing up. So I thought, well, let's put them together and see what we've got. And so I've got 3 very different recordings. Actually, the first one we're going to talk about is not vibraphone at all, but rather it's more analog and primitive ancestor, the marimba. And so we're going to start out with an appropriately titled recording, The Color of Wood, because the marimba, unlike its newer relative, the vibraphone, is just a bunch of wooden things that we hit with mallets.
Wooden bars.
Yeah, wooden bars, rosewood, I believe. And, you know, you often hear it, you know, you hear a marimba in classical music too. It has a big disadvantage compared to the vibraphone of not having much sustain. So you hit that note and it disappears pretty quickly. So you're kind of limited in some ways with the effects you can get out of it. But we have a real mallet maestro here, Tom Collier. He has a really long career, about 60 years he's been playing.
Wow.
He's also an academic. He was the director of percussion studies at the University of Washington School of Music from 1980 to 2016. And he was also a professor of percussion and jazz studies. As a performer, he's got a really impressive resume playing with such names in various genres here. We've got Eddie Daniels, the great clarinetist, Ry Cooder, Earl Hines, Roger Kellaway, Don Grusin, Frank Zappa, Victor Feldman. Let's see who else. Ernie Watts, Cal Jader, Shelly Mann, the great jazz drummer, Buddy DeFranco, another jazz clarinetist, Diane Schur, Peggy Lee, vocalists, Natalie Cole, add in there too, Bobby Shue, the great jazz trumpeter, Sammy Davis Jr., Barbara Streisand, Johnny Mathis, Olivia Newton-John, the Beach Boys,
wow,
the Mills Brothers, Della Reese, the guys played... played around.
He must be exceptionally good to have played with some of these people who are really demanding. You know?
So here we've got a jazz-based marimba album, and a lot of it is new original compositions written specifically for the marimba. Here, a few older kind of original tunes that he had too, and a couple standards or jazz and pop tunes thrown in. So. Marimba is probably more common in classical music to be recorded. And there's not a lot of jazz marimba albums, just completely marimba. So this is kind of a adventurous concept to do all marimba. And I should say on this, some of the tracks are a single track recording, just call your own marimba, but there are some where he's playing along with himself with two, three, or up to four overdubbed tracks.
So I was wondering if there were other players on this album. So I knew, but it's all him overdubbed.
It's all him.
Okay. I thought we had like a baritone sax situation like from last week or something.
Right. No, it's just him. And if you've watched Vibes or Marimba being played, there's two techniques really you can use just a single mallet in each hand, and you're hitting individual notes, and then there's two mallets in each hand, and I've always wondered how they get those intervals spaced out, the mallets coming out like in a Y shape, and I guess it's just a sense you develop like on any instrument, so you could get up to four notes at a time, but there's a lot more going on than that on some of these cuts. In any case, it's all done on marimba by a single performer, and I think he does add a little tambourine also on one of the tracks here, just for a little touch. Anyway, we start out with the title track, The Color of Wood. This one, it's kind of made of rhythmic riffs and chromatic patterns that cross back and forth. It works into a jazzy melody line over chords. I'm guessing this is one that has overdubs because there's a lot going on here. It becomes really hypnotic, but it stays interesting. The rhythmic precision is very impressive for a solo performer because, he's playing, it's a percussion instrument, but he's not keeping time per se, as you would having a drummer. And there's a lot going on that locks in really tightly here. Then we've got kind of a little suite of pieces, five pieces that are part of Five Reflections on Wood, beginning with Portrait of Cheryl. This is kind of starts with a rhythmic static chord that sets a basis for these little peppered figures that develop into another rhythmic line and share a melody on the top of that. There's some impressive fast 16th notes that give the impression of sustain in the harmonies, and the melody lines are like really fast machine gun fire. So because you don't get much sustain on that, he sort of compensates for that with rapid strikes of the same note or other notes, which end up, giving that machine gun type effect. But in order to draw out sort of more extended sounds from the marimba, you've got to keep hitting it. The second piece in the Reflections on Wood is A Sister's Radiant Painting. This one's kind of interesting. It's some spaced out syncopated chords that create some anticipation. There's a sparse line that turns into a slow rolling figures. And it gets a pentatonic feel to the notes that give a kind of orientalism suggestion to it. Figures of different rhythms enter and exit with space giving a kind of impressionistic feeling. I got the sense from this, he's outlining the different parts of a painting, sort of like moving on to a different area of the scene, rather than creating a linear narrative. That's kind of the impression I got in sound, that it's moving around this painting. The next, number three in the reflections, is Portrait of a Scarlet Flower. This is a pretty rubato flowing melody line that has a lot of intervals and intriguing harmonies as well. The next one, number four, Shelling at Horsehead Bay. It starts with an ostinato lower riff intro, and it turns into a 12-bar blues, actually, but with some different descending chord changes that mix it up, and it doesn't land back on the tonic, but rather propels it into the next chorus. This one has to be multiple tracks as well, because he keeps that ostinato riff going, then he adds chords on top of that, and there's a melody line on top of that, all marimba, so no one has enough arms or mallets to do that all on its own. But it's quite an interesting effect with this odd blues here. And the final piece in the five reflections is Ode to a Sunset. This one also gets an impressionistic feel, with bass notes starting rising figures, kind of like a Debussy kind of doom-boo-doom-doom, kind of rising tones. It's quite sparse, mostly with one note at a time, short chord hits between up and down runs. It works into some rolling trills before it returns to the beginning rising figures again. This one's quite pretty.
Yeah.
And we've got an interesting title, Dance of the Avaricious Dolt.
I thought that was hilarious.
That one, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a very rhythmic 6 or 12-8 modal dance. I'm not sure how they're grouped, but the rhythm's interesting. There's a lot of cross rhythms going on and some blazing mallet work here. Again, he's got a bass riff, chord patterns, and a melody line all going on, so it must be multi-tracked, but very technically impressive. After that, we're going to go to a cover tune by the great Freddie Hubbard, my trumpet hero when I was young. I got a chance to meet in person. One of his lovely compositions called Little Sunflower. This is a really pretty tune, and I like what he's done with it here. He's got a lazy bass riff that he invents for the tune. He brings out the harmonic twists under the endearing melody. Then he plays a jazzy solo, hinting at some bluesy ideas, and then he gets a little more adventurous with the harmonic ideas in his solo. He returns to the melody once again in the middle and solos more softly, and then the riff changes up at the end as it fades away. It's just a pretty tune, but he does nice service to the melody. Track 9, Galvanic Juncture, another original, starts rubato, gains motion, exploring a theme over some pretty minor chords. There are lots of intervals and arpeggios along the way, and the tempo changes up to match Collier's ideas with some pauses in between those ideas. This one sounds like a one-track tune. I think he's doing this all just in one go. Now we've got the first of strange choice of covers. We're going to go a little country here. Hank Williams, I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry. This one starts out with a little rising and falling riff to get the old country tune going. Collier plays the melody harmonized sparsely, interspersing that original opening riff in between phrases. He keeps the loping feel into his improvisation, hinting some bluesy phrases and a little kind of galloping rhythm he throws in, like a little horse motif there. And he finishes off with another run through the melody.
Yeah, this was kind of... Yeah, it was an odd interpretation, I thought, because I was kind of trying to listen for the melody, and it's hard to identify, I thought. Yeah,
it's hard to get some twang on marimba, the country twang. It's an odd choice, right? Next, we've got Genesee, And I assume this is not about our old beer from New York, because it it's actually quite pretty. It's another Roboto one. It's lush, pretty harmonies. Collier keeps this one rather soft, highlighting the rich chords. It does get a little bit more animated with some running lines midway through the piece. Track 12, Hopscotch. This one's a fun rhythmic piece. It gets kind of a calypso feel. The fast-running melody lines and punching syncopated chords he places underneath that. But the intro and outro sections feel like they have 7-beat phrases that it sort of jumps into the next phrase. So that creates anticipation moving forward, but that changes in once it gets into the main tune. Track 13, I Haven't Seen the Rain.
I think that's a takeoff on John Fogerty, probably.
Yeah, have right. I want to know.
Creed's Clearwater Revival.
Never Seen the Rain. This is kind of an impressionistic piece. It begins with high intervals that get faster, like raindrops falling at the beginning of a storm. It develops into a very linear rolling piece with waves of gentle sound that come out. And then there's an ending flurry that slows up again like raindrops at the end of a storm. It's kind of charming and picturesque.
Yeah.
14. The Owls Seem What They Want.
I was trying to figure out what that meant.
I have no idea.
Yeah.
This one starts with some low rhythmic alternating chords that make a hypnotic setting for a melody and some jamming above. Midway through, the chords get more subdivided and faster for a bit, and Collier's improvisations also get more animated. They come again to a heartbeat pulse, only to speed up once more, as do the solo lines. In the chords end, he finishes it up with some echoey hits and a final low tone. And we're going to end up the recording with another odd choice of cover tunes. Roy Orbison and Joel Melson's Crying. He presents this in a way, starting out, that he stretches out the rhythm of this famous melody at the start. You might not recognize it because the rhythm is unusual until he hits the higher phrase in the first part of the melody. Then it will become familiar. Single sparse notes and minimalistic playing of the melody becomes more animated as he improvises over it. He returns with a harmonized version of the melody, then adding a rhythmic accompaniment that sounds like a giant music box unwinding as the tension leaves its spring. So this is a unusual recording with all marimba. It might be a little bit mallet overdose. One instrument.
Yeah, I that's what I thought about it, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe of, you know, main instrument or main interest to percussionists and marimba players, just because of the interesting sort of development that goes into multiple tracks here and getting the most out of marimba. But I found it kind of interesting and something I wouldn't normally listen to. A marimba all by itself, but he seems to be an accepted master of this instrument. So it was nice to step into a little world where it's just, you know, felt covered tips striking wood and what kind of music you can get out of that. And so it was like an enchanted little fairy tale land of percussive sound for me. And yeah, something different.
Yeah, he gets he gets a lot of different sounds out of the instrument too, including one that sounds like there's no attack. He's able to kind of like just kind of get the sound without the attack, which I thought was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
My introduction to the marimba came from recordings of Keiko Abe, one of the great virtuosos of the instrument. And she played all these really exciting pieces. And the pieces he's recorded here, the arrangements, they kind of come across more as like salon pieces. Like they're all like 3 or 4 minutes long. Think Clair de Lune by Debussy or the Arabesque or things like that. So they're not really harmonically, you know, like challenging or anything like that. They're pleasant, basically, all of these. They're rhythmically exciting at times. I just thought that there was a little, the sound didn't really change all that much as the instrument as the recording went on, you did hear layers of the the instrument. He has 15 tracks on this album, which makes it a pretty long album. And I guess I could have listened to it like one or two tracks of it at a time. And he probably wanted to, you know, get these recordings out of him and things like that. I don't think this is an album that you listen to all in one sitting, as I did, which was probably a mistake. Yeah. But it was a little too much. But the playing is excellent on this.
Yeah. Well, I should say, you know, probably this is probably a Corona project. He was locked in a room with his marimba and he said, okay, let me play something. Let me play myself over that. And then let me add another part on it. And because he has, if you're interested, he has, as I said, he's played with all these other greats. He also plays vibraphone as well, mainly. And, you know, he's actually even, he's getting up there in years. He's got a few recordings out in the past couple of years as well. I just picked up on this one because it was the newest thing here. So yeah, maybe too much marimba for some, but
I think marimba players will love it. I think he probably shows off a lot of techniques that they want to.
Yeah. Anyway, I thought I'd include that in for a little variety, and we're going to shift over back to the main instrument that's used in jazz.
The jazz
these days,
instrument,
the vibes. Yeah. And got a debut recording.
Not used often enough, I think.
Not often enough, but hopefully we'll hear more. Two very contrasting recordings on vibes, but we're going to start with the first recording of a vibraphonist originally from Greece, Dimitris Angelakis. His recording, Long Way Home. And, well, it's on the record label PK, but that's not the letter P. That's the Greek alphabet P.
God. So it's it's Phi.
Phi, but I guess they pronounce it as P if it's in the capital. This is the capital. Oh. So we often see the lowercase version, and I guess it's also used as a number, like 80 in Greek numeral. But it looks really weird in a regular computer font. So when
it's all Greek to me, Russ.
Yeah, it's all Greek, and these names are going to get you here too.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's see the background of Angelakis here. He's a son of a Greek trumpet player and arranger. He started to make a career for himself in Europe with a number of Greek orchestras. Then he came to Philadelphia on a Fulbright. He got a master's degree at the University of the Arts studying vibraphone. And he also came to New York to study with Christos Rafalidis, vibraphonist, who had been a student of Angelakis' father. He was his first inspiration for the jazz vibraphone. So I guess he started out mainly as a classical player. Then he studied with a number of other vibe players. After that, he spent a year in China recording working with Asian musicians and teaching and performing with Chinese musicians. And from those experiences, he's put together this recording here, Long Way Home. He's got a rhythm section team here along with him that works out to be pretty interesting. The pieces here tell a story with inspirations particular to his home country of Greece, and also his experience of immersing himself in the culture of American jazz. And, well, it comes out to be a really interesting experience. So we've got himself, Dimitris Angelakis, on vibraphone, George Kontraforis on piano, Kimon Karotsis on bass. There's a lot of Greeks here. Even though they're all American.
And they can really play, though. Yeah. This is a good record.
And it's an really un-Greek sounding Jason Waster on drums.
The odd man out.
The odd man out. Now, I should say, the Kontraforis on piano, he's actually on Rhodes most of the time here. And, you know, this kind of, on the vibraphone, if you know how the vibraphone works as, you know, the marimba as we were saying, you're basically hitting wood. That's all you got. But the vibraphone is actually, it's an electronic instrument. If I don't know if listeners know, but we used to have one when I was in high school. I like to play around with it. You know, so you've got a couple pedals, and so one is a mute pedal, you know, that actually holds a mute on the bar. So if you just hit it, it won't get any sustain at all. So it sounds like a xylophone or something almost. If you take the mute off, the tone will ring out for the natural duration. But there's another pedal that controls the rotor. So underneath the metal box on the vibraphone, you've got these tubes, and there's a resonator. So you've got a rod that goes through them all, and little circular discs that rotate, you know, that are on actually a little, what do I say? There's a pulley there and a belt that drives that. So you get that kind of, I don't know, it's kind of a tremolo vibrato thing going. We combine that with the sort of sounds you get from a Rhodes piano. You could end up with a wash of sound competing with each other.
Oh, cool.
But that doesn't happen in this recording. They really used those kind of enveloping tones quite well for a wash of sound that I thought was attractive. And we've got an interesting group of compositions. So let's take a look at what we've got here. We're going to start with an original tune called Murphy.
Not a very Greek-sounding name.
Yeah, sounds like some Irishman at the bar. But this is cool. It's a syncopated and boppy original tune. The bass and vibes double parts of the melody to a very cool effect. Then the Rhodes joins in, too. There's some nice Rhodes and bass unison counterlines in sections, too. So I like how they're doubling up these parts as they trade off. The tonal combination of vibes and Rhodes is very interesting. Angelicus comes charging out for a solo first. He's got a good swing feel, nice intensity to his playing. They work through the melody again, and Kourtzis is up for a bass solo, getting up high with some double stops too. Very cool. Wastor gets some drum time over a vampy interlude, and it hits a new rising R&B type groove that comes out of this jazz feel in the drums and bass. Contraforce is up for an acoustic piano solo then. He makes it funky and rhythmic. You want him to keep going, but nope, it fades out. Anyway, you're off to a high energy start.
Yeah, I thought the who was playing during the fade? There was a new instrument that came in, I thought, and the piano starts soloing.
Yeah, acoustic.
And he doesn't
piano,
get much. They just fade him out. I thought that was really weird. Yeah. Anyway, I was disappointed. He was soloing well. He was interesting. As was everyone else.
Yeah,
it was a good track.
Let him play out for more there.
I thought.
Now we've got, I guess, one of our Greek-inspired titles, Ulysses' Journey. A solo vibes intro here with a music box-like melody. The band joins in on a hit, and there's a groove started with light cymbals and rising three-note bass patterns. Contraforce adds a layer of Rhodes chords underneath that. Then the melody modulates, goes through another section with vibes and keyboard in unison with repeated rhythmic figures. It settles into a peaceful groove for Angelicus to start his solo here. His lines are very fluid. Also, he has a lot of nice ornaments, little trills like appoggiatura things. I think he got that from his classical background. He can add those into his improvisations nicely. They repeat the rhythmic melody section. There's a dropping away of everything for some high and straight-toned vibes enchantment.
I use the word enchanting, too, for this section.
Yeah. A new section over long bass tones starts to build up, and then Angelicus builds up some vibe phrases again. Contraforce takes over with some very funky Rhodes playing, and then they join together over the intense drumming of Wastor, having arrived at the destination of the journey. There's a sudden stop, and then it ends with some magical vibe tones and a final chord.
Yeah,
enchanting piece. It is like a little journey. You feel the anticipation of setting out on a trek and then the joy of arriving at a place with it. Another original for track three, Only For You. This is a lush, slow ballad. Kurotsu's bass sounds fat under the swirling vibe melody and Rhodes chords. The melody is pretty and has a few attractive rhythmic hitches in it. So it sort of skips and syncopates to keep you on your toes. Contraforce gets phasery. I just made that up. On a Rhodes interlude before the vibes are back and the tempo picks up. But it transforms again into a very meaty bass solo. This is a really good bass solo. It's got double stops with bends. And some
I said there are some cool bends in his solo too.
Bluesy riffs. I mean, if you can think, you know, he's double stopping and bending, this guy must have like a grip like a, you know, an iron claw or something. I recommend shaking hands with him. But it sounds really cool. You don't usually hear that.
I remember I got to play like an acoustic bass and I had to like tape my two end fingers together in order to get a sound out of that because they're both too weak to push the string down.
Yeah.
It was really hard.
Doing double stops and bending both of them. That's pretty impressive. And it sounds very cool. The beat is heavier after that, and then Angelicus joins in with some bluesy mallet work over the fat Rhodes chords and insistent drumming. It slows down and ends on an unexpected chord. This is a very cool piece.
All right.
Track four, Joe's Corner. This was a melody of descending notes and synchronized block chords on the vibes. Bass and Rhodes move in step two, then adding their own unison answer tags. The drums fill in busy beats. There's a second section of the melody that contrasts with that first part. Angelicus solos over the undulating rhythm underneath that builds up and kind of bursts into a swing over the walking bass and furious cymbals. Nice punctuated Rhodes chords again underneath. The rhythm transforms to something more freeform over repeated note bass patterns and more straight rhythm drumming. It dissolves down for Contraforce to get started on a raucous piano solo, Rhodes actually, that he brings the swing back into again. That runs into a repeat of the melody, first part of the melody as a vamp for some explosive drumming. And then they let it run its course, bringing it down once more for some restrained vibe work and two flourishing holds at the end. Another exciting piece. Now we've got a cover of another jazz musician, pianist Walter Bishop Jr.'s Coral Keys. This one starts with a super funky and fun bass line intro that takes it into kind of a Brazilian beat, and Angelicus gets tropical with the melody that has some nice rhythmic accented surprises. Contraforce has a Rhodes solo with groovy lines and lots of fleet runs, and then Waster has some huge drum hits as Angelicus finds the blues at the beginning of his solo. He continues on showing some impressive speedy figures in an enthusiastic solo. I think I hear some Keith Jarrett-y happy grunting behind there. things in there, but why not? They're having a good time. They take the melody for another ride with a few embellishments and have a nice little vibes cadenza at the end. Track six, we're going to get another cover of a Bill Evans tune very early. Vimes and Rhodes work the intro together on this one, and then it gets waltzy, with Angelicus carrying the melody in the mid-range of the vibes of punctuated Rhodes chords in there, too. Kurotsis keeps one-bar beats on the bass and occasionally add triplets here. He's up for a solo first, and Angelicus switches to vibes for backing while the Rhodes drops out to keep the sound from getting too thick. Angelicus keeps a solo next, and he keeps the waltz feel swinging along, And then Contraforce has a nice Rhodes solo with lilts and cool intervals in it. They go through the melody again, vamp around for some fiery mallet work from Angelicus, pressed by intense drumming from Waster before ending the tune. So a little Bill Evans tribute there. Track 7, Johnny the Liar. This is another original tune. It's a medium swinging song with some boppy alternative chords and quirky pauses in the melody line. There's a cool bass pickup and interlude bridge before it gets back to the melody, and a solo on the vibes. Contraforce is on acoustic piano here that matches the more sort of traditional bop mood of the tune. He takes a very swinging solo that builds up. He hammers out some bluesy figures at the end of it. They go around the chords with some stop time for Waster to get some drumming in. And there's a bass solo for just one part of the verse, too, that breaks it up nicely. They go around the melody and give Angelicus some more time to play with some hard driving backing. And then he gets a nice little vibes cadenza at the end before a bluesy finish. So another cool original tune. And we end up the whole recording with one standard here, the old Jimmy Van Heusen Polka Dots and Moonbeams. And this is a solo version for vibes. Angelicus plays it rubato, nice pauses, and no vibrato from the resonator, straight toned. He chooses some nice chord voicings to harmonize along the way. Towards the end, he gets a bit more rhythmic, then a little bluesy, finishes it off with some pretty stacked chord ideas. So, great vibe playing, lots of energy, nice variety of material. We've got 5 originals, 1 standard, and 2 covers of jazz originals by jazz greats. The interplay is pleasing. They make the blend of vibes and Rhodes work without letting the sound get murky or in the way of each other. Good interplay and energy. Yeah, let's hear more from this guy. It's got a lot to offer.
Yeah, I like this a lot too. It's one for the collection if it comes out on CD. So if you're listening out there, Mr. Angelakis, I hope you'll release this on a CD so I can keep it forever. I liked it a lot.
Yeah, I might get this one too.
Vibes, yeah, not just the vibes playing, but all the musicians. And I even isolated the bass. I liked him a lot. He stands out. I wanted to mention, the last tune is Polka Dots and Moonbeams, and I just got to tell you a little thing about this. I know this song from the Frank Sinatra version of it. Mm-hmm. And the lyric goes, because I've heard this a million times.
This one has always puzzled me, too.
Yeah, he says, suddenly I saw polka dots and moonbeams all around a pug-nosed dream. Pug-nosed
dream. What the hell
dream.
Is that?
Well, I think what they mean is they have one of those cute curvy noses that's really small, and you know, it's cute. But whenever I hear the word pug nose, I think of the dog called the pug with the smushed in face, you know. So like, what, you know, what's appealing about this? I don't know.
I've always wondered
even
that
when
too.
I was a kid, it always bothered me too. I don't know.
Yeah. Yep, I've always worried about that line too. Yeah.
And what year is this song from? 30s maybe?
Ooh.
40s?
Good question. It's got to be 30s or 40s. Let's find out, you know, because my first exposure to it was, you know, just as a jazz instrumental when I was young. Then I think I heard like the Four Freshmen or someone sing it. And I was kind of like, did they just say Pug Nose Dream? You know.
Well, Frank Sinatra, you definitely hear him say it because he kind of hits it with an accent, you know.
And let's see what
he's very clear voice too. You understand every word he says.
Yeah, enunciates very clearly. 1940. Mm. There you go. And Sinatra did it first with the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra, right?
I guess pug-nosed things were, you don't know. I'm trying to think of another 40s expression. I can't, you know. Maybe it's one of those 40s expressions. I don't know.
It just seems to not be that endearing, but hey, what do I
Well, not,
what do I
not
know, yeah?
For our modern age, I guess. I don't know.
I guess, yeah.
I guess it's like a cute little nose. I don't know.
All right. We'll think
anyway.
Of it that way. All right.
It's a nice... But the polka dots and moonbeams image is nice, though. I like that.
I do like that.
Yeah.
Moonbeams. Mm.
Moonbeams.
All right. We're going to end the
Blue Note record. Speaking of.
Yes. The
We have a major mallet label here.
Maestros with another vibraphone recording on Blue Note. Uh-oh, Mike, this is actually kind of a sweet. My vibe's sweet.
Oh, you don't like... yeah, the entire thing is a sweet.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's on it's on Blue Note too, which kind of this whole concept kind of surprised me that they'd go for. I don't really know what Blue Note's image is these days.
It's hard to tell.
In the old
days,
they were kind of more laid back. You know, they were kind of like the laid back jazz sort of. Yeah. But now, yeah, it's hard to tell.
Anyway, we've got
this was a suite, and it suffered from some sweetness, shall we say? If I can, yeah.
Anyway, this
is a little sweet heavy, but it was okay.
The new recording of Joel Ross called The Parable of the Poet. Now, we've heard Ross back in episode 37 as he was a sideman in Jonathan Blake's Homeward Bound, which we liked a lot. And also, this is his third album as a leader, all on Blue Note. He's been busy. Kingmaker in 2019. And Who Are You in 2020? And so here he is with 2022's The Parable of a Poet. Joel Ross on vibraphone, Craig Weinrib on drums, Rick Rosato on bass, Sean Mason on piano, Kalia Vandiver on trombone, Maria Grand on tenor saxophone, Marky Hill on trumpet, Emmanuel Wilkins, we've heard recently as well, on alto saxophone.
Yeah, right. The piano. And, oh, he's a saxophone? Okay.
Yeah. Alto sax. And on one track,
right. I know. Okay.
Gabriel Garo on flute. And so we've got a suite of things with sort of religious overtones here. This whole album, I should say, in contrast to the previous more jazzy standard kind of fare, is more atmospheric and sort of focusing more on tonal kind of development, and it's a suite as it goes through these different movements.
And it suffers from the from those qualities that suites have.
Yeah.
The reason we don't really listen to them.
Yeah.
I don't want to say this about this album because this is not the case with this album. But my definition of a jazz suite is a jazz player's failed college graduation project that nevertheless allowed him to pass his course. which is fine, but the issue is that they have to they then decide to record it for posterity, and then we all have to suffer when we listen to it. Anyway, but that's not the case here. We're not suffering off this. This isn't bad. It's just kind of a... I remember when I was in college, because I had a friend who was in music in college. I had to go to his... He had his graduation performance, and he had all his friends go. You know, you want to support your friends, especially in college, so you go. And it was just this... just totally pretentious thing that included like poetry and music and like this interpretive dance. It was just
that sounds like a Kyoto performance.
Well, it was really horrific, but I don't think he ever recorded it though or filmed it, so to release anywhere. But it was I took one for the team. Let's just say that.
Well, I suppose it allows...
And I told them it was great afterwards, so I guess I'm in a lowest circle of health.
He probably wrote another one after he told them that.
Yeah, he probably did. I didn't want to encourage him too much. But
anyway, I think it's a different format. It allows the musicians and composer to break out of sort of the song structure format into something maybe a little bit more loose, and then looking for, you know, a larger thematic arc of progression through the material. And that's what he's aiming at here with these kind of religious ideas going through here. And, the name Parable of the Poet. So let's see where we start and end here. We begin with prayer. This is credited just to Joel Ross as composition only. Ross gives us a solo intro on the vibes with lots of ringing notes. Gradually, they take shape into a slow melody motif. Piano, bass, and drums come in and also find the motif. Soft saxes, trumpet, and trombone enter, join in around the melody. The motif figure mostly repeats, but there is a variation that goes to minor chords for some contrast in the line. Ross joins back in with the vibes for some little touches in there. The horns start to weave more lines and counterlines over the repeating figure, and then Ross improvises more as the horns form more arranged lines, and finally the focus turns to piano to close it out. Overall, it feels like a meditative prayer, creating a feeling of warmth from the tones.
Yeah, I kind of felt like in this one, the vibrato produced by the vibraphone, it's a really slow sort of vibrato. That forms a lot of the musicality of this piece, which just goes to tell you that's a bit meditative.
Yeah.
You know, he kind of goes for the sound of the instruments really carrying this material. Yeah.
This is really a big focus on tonal palette throughout this whole recording. Track two is Guilt. Composition credits go to Ross, Rosado, Gabriel Garo, and Sergio Tabanico, and I don't know who that is. He's not a performer on this recording. This one starts with a lonesome bass intro by Rosado. It develops into kind of a six-beat waltzing bass pattern. Weinrib adds light drumming. Ross comes in with soft vibe lines, and the piano adds little delicate touches before setting a rhythmic chord figure. The horns join in with soft legato lines. Flute and harmon mute trumpet tones stand out in the mix. Grant gets a soft tenor sax solo over the dreamy mix, and the other horns come in with backing lines that continue on and swell. Ross adds vibraphone runs on top of this building sound. The rhythmic feel changes up from the waltz to a four-beat pattern, mysteriously as it progresses. A sense of rhythmic urgency is developed with subdivided drumming and bluesy vibe and piano figures. Then the trumpet and trombone spin off some rapid improvised lines as they go along, too. It settles down for a quiet ending with the warm flute tone standing out at the end. Track three, Choices. Here, Hill starts this one with a solo trumpet intro, Marquis Hill, that is. After a minute of solo exposition, he's joined by Grant's tenor sax that adds some harmony to his longer notes. Then a rumbling piano and bowed bass come in, and trombone also join to make a dark cloud of sound. Weinrib adds drum textures as the mass of sound clears back to just the horns. Then Ross joins in on vibes and a slow beat forms with the drums and bass. And then the horns improvise lines with Hill's trumpet being the most prominent among them. It comes to a slow end with the horns phrasing together, kind of a unified feel. We get to probably the most intense track on the album, Wail, W-A-I-L. This one starts with rolling tense piano chords and busy drumming makes a setting for the intense sound of Wilkins's alto sax that comes in on the rubato theme. It's a sad minor dirge feeling. The other horns join in around him. Ross adds vibes to the slow moving procession. Vibes and piano are left alone over sparse drumming at about 2.5 minutes. Wilkins comes back in with bone-dry toned cries of phrases that are painfully spaced out. Sounds almost like gasps of air for death. I really like the effect that he gets on that. The other horns add a contrasting kind of velvety backing. And then Wilkins' tone smooths out to sort of match what the other horns have created tonally, but he spins off into more rapid, free-flowing lines on the sax, alto sax there. And Ross eventually joins in with some rapid vibe lines as well. Then things quiet down at the end with only Vandiver left on trombone playing lines over the piano and bass. Next, we've got the impetus, and then in parentheses, to be and do better. Vandiver continues on trombone, where she sort of left off from the previous tune, carrying the melody over the piano to start this tune out. A bass joins in on the minor theme and gives some more rhythmic push. Vandiver gets more sparse midway, leaving Mason on the piano to develop a slow rhythmic riff for the horns to join over. Then the drums get a slow beat formed. Ross adds ringing tones on the vibes to the mix as it gets more of a harmonic progression going. It comes to a pause, returning the focus to some sweet tones by Vandiver, ending on an unresolved chord. Now we've got a few more religious kind of implications here. Track 6, Doxology, starts with flitting tenor sax lines from Grand. Piano, bass, and busy drumming join in on a cycling progression of chords that builds up tension but pulls Grand into more melodic ideas than she started out with on her own. The horns join in with lines under Grand, and then they make their own transition to a piano solo by Mason. Ross joins in then for some light backing as the horns return. Then he takes over the focus with some rapid rhythmic vibraphone improvisations. The horns improvise underneath too, but it suddenly slows down and reduces the energy coming to an end. Then we end up with Benediction. And Mason starts this one out on piano with low chords and rhythmic higher repeating notes. It goes through some harmonic changes of big open chords. A slow beat in 6 forms as Ross drums and bass enter on a downbeat. The horns come in too with a warm moving line underneath, and Ross solos on vibes above, keeping it in the middle and lower end of the range of the instrument this time. The horns noodle and doodle underneath the vibes as the tune moves along, and it starts to fade out. It's a long, slow fade to the end as it goes out, and that's it. So the focus here is a lot on tone and texture. Ross is no show-off, that's for sure. He gives most of the spotlight goes to all of his sidemen, and he seems to be, you know, focused mainly on creating an atmosphere around his kind of theme. There's a few moments of higher intensity, like Whale there. And there's a lot of interplay and improvisation on the lines. I get the idea this was constructed on a loose sort of plan of lines, and he encouraged the players, especially the horns, to add their own little ad-libs there as long as they create the overall mood and impression of Ross's vision of these songs here. It's a suite, as you said. Not bad. It's very chilled and mellow. There's improvisations and looseness going on. It all sticks together, but it's generally a laid back kind of progression through these different themes.
I think one of the issues with the jazz suite is that when someone calls their piece a suite, it kind of indicates that they want to say something to you that's a little heavier than what they're going to come up with in the moment, say in an improvisation. So it's something they've kind of thought about, and so it adds weight to that. I don't think we like to hear too much weight in a jazz piece. I mean, save that for like the big classical works, right? But this album I thought was okay. I mean, I enjoyed the heavy vibrato tone of the vibes. I thought it was a really beautiful sound, but the piece as a whole, like I thought it was kind of a downer. I mean, I kind of came out of it feeling a little more unhappy than I was going in.
Right.
It wasn't sad, but it just kind of, it didn't really lift my spirits at all. Good playing all around, though. Everybody plays really well. And there were terrific moments also in the ensemble work and solos, but all in all, I kind of didn't take to this much.
Yeah, it's not, It's not that it could be more exciting, I thought.
Well, I think his sweet message is kind of a
I guess
he wants to be communicate his view stuff, of God so. To us. But I think I think classical music is actually better at that. kind of because the structure kind of helps, I think.
Anyway, it's enjoyable for the thick palette of sounds that develop. It's nice. You've got in the horns, you've got trombone, tenor sax, alto sax, trumpet, and flute in there. So you get a rich kind of mixture of sounds. So in that case, there's a lot of tones to listen to here. My pick for the unexpected and happy find is Dimitris Angelicus.
Yeah, I like Long that Way too. Home. That was like,
yeah, I just saw that on one of my lists of things that come out from around the world, and I thought, let's check this out. And so I was really happy to find that. So that's my pick that probably will pass under the radar of most jazz listeners. Joe Ross's not bad. It's on Blue Note. It's going to get a lot of attention. You can check that out. And for any percussionists or real mallet heads who are serious into percussion, check out The Color of Wood. It's a lot of marimba all in one place, but well done. And, it's just a focus on mallet maestros. So.
Yeah.
How much music can you get out of hitting little blocks of wood and metal? Well, get some interesting stuff, and that's what we focused on tonight. So.
Yeah, I'm guessing we're going to give this episode the title Mallet Maestros, yet I liked the classical recordings tonight better. I was kind of more into those.
Of course, we got a new Runitsky, which is always good. And I like the Beethoven, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, the drone one.
A nice discovery.
Yeah. The drone one was interesting, too. Yeah.
Yeah, next week I've got another potential discovery for us. It's just a little... Are we ready for the coming attractions? You know what you're doing next week, or...?
Yeah, coming attractions. What do you got next week?
Okay, well, I've got one of our favorite composers. We have two classical performers that we've already talked about making a return, with their new albums from this year. One of them is music by one of our favorite composers on the Adult Music Podcast, C.P.E. Bach, on a recording that features Justin Taylor, the harpsichordist that we like so much on the, we talked about his Rameau recording, La Famille Rameau last year. And then we have, Nielsen and Sibelius violin concertos played by Johan Dahlén, and we heard his kind of Scandinavian violin and piano album last year that was
I remember. He's a really young guy, isn't he?
Yeah, he's a young guy, and here he's in two big concertos, and I'm really curious to hear how he's going to do this. And then we have a set of clarinet works, Bassett clarinet, in fact, not just the clarinet. It has the bass clarinet gets some lower tones on it, which, of course, is always going to be appealing to me. I love those low reed sounds. So the Mozart clarinet concerto and a new concerto. Let me take a look at this guy by Wim Hendricks called Sutra. And it's inspired by yoga. And
this is going to lend itself to lots of jokes.
Maybe, unless it's a great piece. I mean, I haven't heard it yet, but we'll have to. You never know. It might be this great new discovery. For bassett clarinet.
My chakras are aligning already.
Oh, there's so many potential good jokes from this. But it might be a great piece, though, so we'll have to hear it first. We will give it a, we will give it a very respectful review, despite the jokes, unless we don't like it, of course, but that depends.
Yeah,
I for one am curious to hear. I think this might be the first piece ever dedicated to yoga in the classical tradition that's ever been laid down on paper. So
might
I'm
be
have
the
to
last one we ever
that.
Talk about. Too.
Not if the jokes are good, it won't be.
Yeah, no, that's true too. We'll have to find good things to make fun of. Now, anyway, I'm going to go off riff on that theme with all clarinet recordings next week.
Okay.
So I've got a Latin clarinet. I've got kind of jazz tribute one. And then I've been deciding, or actually, since you're doing yoga Maybe I should go with that Indian one.
Are you going to go with the Indian one?
No, I don't think so. Yeah. I think I'm going to go with the other one because there's a recording that's got both clarinet and bass clarinet.
You can't not have the bass clarinet. Come on.
Okay, so we got to go with that one for sure. So it's going to be all clarinet.
Because you know how we love that, man. We love those low reeds. Those are fantastic sounding instruments.
So we'll do all clarinet next week. And I think I've got enough for a flute episode too, which would be cool. And
I've got the flute because the CPE Bach has a flute on it too. It's too bad. I'm already doing that one next week. But anyway.
And then as we were discussing earlier, I think in works I'm going to have an Italian jazz episode, like piano paisans or something like that. I don't have enough Italian piano too, but
hey,
I've got a
paisan.
Yeah. Hey, paisan. But I've got enough other recordings too. I think I've got two new Italian trumpeter recordings, so I'll mix it up with the instruments. But we've got a lot of
really intriguing stuff on the way too for the next
Spanish
few months. So we should
jazz
be okay
too. We could do this. I could do this every day.
I could too.
Send the checks. Send the checks to R&M Studio and.
Given the money, I'd have. I'd need a new house though to house my ever-growing CD collection.
If Deezer hired us and put us on to be their curator instead of any of these streaming services,
you know who should hire us? Apple Music. They need us.
Apple needs us. Yeah.
Yeah. Spotify needs us too. They're not good as far as classical goes. Yeah.
And if we were on the streaming service, we could actually play the music too. So, we could just put it all together and not worry about copyright things. So, anyway.
I rely heavily on Presto Music in England for new releases, though. So I guess they're on top of their game. So
They're late. They're 30 days behind the releases on when
sometimes
stuff comes
out. Sometimes, they are. I've noticed that.
That's why they need us. We're out there, curators for hire. Going to get the most interesting cutting edge things. So come on, streaming service, send us your offers.
Yeah, they're off at least a week behind on a lot of releases by labels outside of England. But I guess that's understandable, though. But it's hard to know what's going on.
We're here to help. That's what we're doing. We're providing a service to the music community.
There it is. Yeah. Anyway, giving you some good stuff to listen to. Brighten up your life. I want to tell you, doing this podcast, I now have to listen to 6 albums a week, and I've changed for the better by doing that. I think it kind of tuned my brain waves in an appealing way. It's certainly given me a more positive outlook on life. So we suggest you do the same. Listen to these recordings.
I mean, listening is fun, but listening and trying to be able to relay that at least somewhat comprehensibly is a tall order, but it really brings you into the music. It's been fun for me, and I hope that even if people get tired of listening to our blathering about the tunes, they actually listen to the actual music.
Well, you don't want to hear us talk about it. You want to hear what it sounds like. We're just trying to get you to listen to
get
it.
You to
That's
listen
all.
To the music. So listen to our jokes. Because especially if we're going to have yoga and clarinet, I mean, that's just...
I don't know.
That's just asking for some good jokes there. But we'll
watch
see what
this
happens.
Piece like blow us away now. We're going to be like, oh, it's the best thing ever. I don't know.
We're going to all convert to Hinduism or something. Anyway, we'll see what happens with that. A lot of things coming up in the pipeline. This has been episode 61 of Adult Music, the podcast with music for the mature mind. And once again, we want to thank Fast Signs of Staten Island for our cool neon glowing logo. I noticed ever since we got that up there, there's a bunch of new podcasts that are trying to capture that neon theme.
Yeah. It stands out because I see it on my, because I have like Apple Podcasts, I have like a Mac. And when I put the podcast thing up, it just stands out in the whole crowd. It's really...
None of the other ones I've seen look as good as that one. So please do like and subscribe on whatever platform you listen to us on. Check us out on Facebook. We've got our page there with our handsome mugs. Send us an instant message on Facebook or write to us direct. Email adultmusicpodcast, all one word, @gmail.com. Do check us out on Deezer if you want to find out the playlist for next week. I'll have that up tomorrow. It'll also be on the Facebook page.
And I'm going to put up a photo of the CDs on the Facebook page. Check that out.
Yeah, okay. Check that out. And I'll put up any associated videos of live performances with the jazz so you can get a little extra insight if you come over to the Facebook page. Well, until then, in episode 62 next week, we wish you a happy week of listening, and we'll see you again next time.